The old enemy is back. And in a fetching new shade.
I think the blue one's my favourite.
It's all new Doctor Who. What's the other thing we haven't changed? Let's change the Daleks too.
And all that stands in their way is one man with a blue box and one man with a cigar.
Go for it, Blue Captain! Go to it!
My ambition with this episode really was to do a sort of 45-minute bank holiday war movie.
Mark Gatiss takes us to Churchill's cabinet war rooms.
We don't know how lucky we are.
For an inside view on how the war was won.
I would urge anybody who can to come and visit this place.
And how Mark pitted the Doctor's deadliest enemy against the best of British.
It's like British icons shoved together. Bizarrely, the Daleks feel as though they're part of it.
Join us as we see the Daleks go bigger, badder, and brighter.
They've improved, they're stronger, they're more powerful, they're more brilliant. It's exciting, it's sort of what it's about, Doctor Who, I think. Every monster gets a little better every time.
In a top-secret military installation, the Doctor Who team are filming the nerve centre of the British war effort.
I'm just asking everybody to go to their start positions.
P-camera.
Back in action! Action!
And are they ready?
I hope so. In the meantime, this will pick up Dalek transmissions.
On the paradigm of a new Dalek race.
It's a Doctor.
Well, you know, nice paint job. I'd be feeling pretty swishy if I look like you. Pretty supreme.
He's got company. New company. We've got to hurry up.
Go to it, Group Captain. Go to it. Broadsword to Danny Boy. Broadsword to Danny Boy. Scramble. 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 You heard him, Group Captain. Hand him all we've got.
Broadsword to Danny Boy. Target the dish and stop that signal. Over.
Understood, sir. Over.
We're going in.
Good luck, lads.
Dalek hits up.
This episode has been written by long-time Doctor Who contributor Mark Gatiss, who's been asked to work his magic on World War II.
I remember I took him out for a drink and said, look, I want you to do the Daleks, meet Churchill. And he was, you know, initially he was sort of, yeah, OK, I don't think he immediately leapt at it.
The Churchill bit, I went, oh. The Dalek bit, I went, oh. It's thrilling, obviously it is. So I just sort of took a deep breath, really.
And I got very, very excited very quickly about the idea of, first of all, writing a sort of war movie, of which I'm inordinately fond, but particularly about sort of doing my own Dalek story and contributing and continuing the mythos.
I wondered what sort of a match he'd be for the Daleks, but actually he's been a brilliant match for the Daleks and absolutely adored writing them.
And it's so kind of Doctor Who, that panning.
It is, I know, it? I know. It's a little does
yeah,
to
it
you.
Does.
To be in anything by Mark is, for me, a treat, because I'm just that, you know, that's that. I'm really awestruck by him. I'm really starstruck. And he's such a fan of Doctor Who. And he's so good in it, you know, in the episode he's in, he's so good.
1940. Remember? Night after night. Explosions. Guns. Firestorms.
And it's lovely to have such a great big fan write the show. Like, you know, kind of Stephen is a huge fan, like Russell is a huge fan. I think that gives it great heart. And I think Mark's episode is full of heart.
I knew that he would write Churchill really, really well. I knew he'd do his research properly, because Mark always does. I knew he'd get that part of it right, and I knew he'd get the feel of the wartime characters brilliantly.
In his research, Mark visited the cabinet war rooms in Whitehall. Confidential took him back there to experience the real nerve centre of the British war machine.
So here we are, not in the room where Doctor Who is written, although it's very like this, but at the top secret heart of the war effort.
otherwise known, Cressida.
This is the Chechen Museum and Cabinet War Rooms, which preserves the original cabinet war rooms.
And how far are we beneath the beating heart of London?
We're only about 10 foot down.
Disappointing?
Yes. People here would have felt they were a lot lower, lower down.
And there is how much concrete between us and the pavement?
It's about 3 metres. It's a great big slab with reinforced iron rails in it, protecting us a bit. Right. They had the rooms ready before war broke out in 1938, and they moved in here more permanently during the Blitz in 1940.
And before we go inside, tell us what this is, because it's fantastic.
This originally was a light push, but somebody has cleverly adapted it to make a cigarette lighter. You know, like in use in cars, so obviously that filament lights up. Because this is the map room, full of paper and naked flames, just wouldn't have been a good idea.
Could actually plug your sat nav into that. Speaking of which, let's go inside.
So this is the map room.
Yes.
Now our version in Doctor Who is considerably bigger, and has one of those big tables with a map of Southeast England and WAFs pushing that. Now that obviously never happened here. Those are real though, aren't they?
Yes.
Boxes, but not here.
Those would have been in the RAF bases.
Right.
And this was a sort of combined services, bringing all the different services together and coordinating the information. And this was manned 24 hours a day throughout the entire war.
Good Lord. And it would have been, I suppose, in a fog of tobacco.
Yes.
Smoke and everything else.
Yeah, and you can see the huge cigarette boxes. So, as far as we know, pretty much everybody smokes.
Gosh. It's amazing they lasted through the war.
Yes.
And the map is absolutely covered in tiny drawing pin marks.
Yes, so this is the convoy map.
Yeah.
So it's it would have been plotting the individual convoys of ships which were coming across the Atlantic, bringing sort of vital supplies and men battling against the U-boats.
So this... The entire place was sealed in May 1945?
In September 1945, after the end of the war with Japan.
And was left exactly as it was?
Yes, yeah, so the most important rooms, so this room and the war cabinet room, for example, were left exactly as they were, and very few people came down here. A few people sort of requested to go on tours, and they come down with torches,
right.
But it wasn't open to the public.
That's spooky. Was it sealed up because of the secrecy, or because they had a sense that it was an important place?
I think they understood the historical value.
Right. Yes. Extraordinary.
So on this notice board, they were keeping the score of the Battle of Britain from down here. Somebody's painted it in for September the 15th, 1940, which is Battle of Britain Day, when the tide of the battle changed finally in Britain's favour.
God, extraordinary thought, isn't it?
I mean, they were realistically down here being aware that they could be invaded. And their rooms further down the corridor where they were planning the defence of the country.
Well,
if
what
they
was
were invaded.
It? Rifles?
Down here they had rifles.
Yeah.
People working here would have been expected to defend themselves, defend the site. But it's things like barbed wire on the beaches and things as well like that.
Yeah. Lord. We don't know how lucky we are. And Doctor Who, as usual, found its own particular way to pay tribute to those magnificent men in their flying machines.
It was Steve's idea. He just said, we've got to have Spitfires in space. How can we make that happen?
Danny boy to the Doctor.
I wanted to fly one of the Spitfires. I get the TARDIS, it's, you know, it's cool.
It's such an icon, isn't it, the Spitfire? It remains with you.
To realise the dream of Spitfires in space, the team go into the studio for some camera trickery.
I think you can go real RAF and... Oh, I'm Danny Boy.
Yeah, a little bit. We shot a lot of the Spitfire with the pilot against green to create the CG dogfight in space between the Spitfires and their pilots and the Dalek spaceship. So what we did in order to help with those CG shots is to shoot the live action elements, which is the cockpit and the main fuselage of the Spitfire.
Very good. Cut there.
Cut it.
Well, we have a World War II replica Spitfire here in the studio today, in a green screen studio. And this afternoon we're shooting the live action element of what will become a CG Spitfire dogfight in space. I wouldn't want to go in a Spitfire. I just had a look in the cockpit, and I just don't know how those guys managed to fend off the Luftwaffe in those things. You know, you look in that cockpit, it's cramped, the controls are confusing, you can't see out of the cockpit ahead of you because the engine is so high in front of you. I mean, I just don't know how they do it. They're amazing guys, those pilots. Absolutely amazing.
Danny Boy to the doctor. Come in. Over.
With CG these days, you can pretty much do anything you like, but in order to get to that place where it's believable, you have to use the real thing, you know. And although this isn't a real Spitfire, it's a replica, it's it looks pretty amazing.
It's print the legend again. Everybody thinks of the Spitfire as the plane that won us the war, and it's more or less true. So it just had to be, you know.
Danny Boy to the doctor, going in for another attack.
Just to have a Spitfire in space is only in Doctor Who could it ever happen, which is why this show's so brilliant, I think. Spitfires in space with Churchill and the Daleks and a force field round them and the TARDIS, you know, and really posh men going, Danny Boy, over and out. Only Doctor Who.
In the Second World War, Britain needed a leader, and that leader needed a war room.
So Churchill said he would run the war from here.
Yes.
How much of it did he?
Well, this is the War Cabinet Room, and he was here for 1 in 10 of all the War Cabinet meetings.
Right.
So it's 115 times they met down here.
Blimey. It's amazing to think what happened in this room.
Yeah, so really important decisions, sort of discussions on the bombing of German cities.
And terrible rows, I imagine.
Yes, I'm sure it was very heated.
And this is Churchill's chair?
Yes, Churchill sat in the middle here. And we've got scratches on the end of the arms. Apparently he had quite long fingernails and a signet ring, and he'd scratch the ends of the chair.
Got in sheer frustration.
Yes.
He was apparently a very difficult boss. Imagine, but everyone was utterly devoted
to
him.
Yes, they were very loyal to him.
Yeah.
But I think he liked to have his own way.
And the air is filtered all the way around.
Yes, it's not actually air-conditioned air, so it's just forced air from outside. Not filtered, so very dusty and coming right down.
And so from Whitehall, it'd be full of fumes, and from the air race, full of dust.
Yeah, dust.
Yeah, so probably better not to have it.
Yes. One of the typists who worked down here, still alive, was telling us that she got really bad catarrh and really big problems with her lungs and had to stop working down here because of the fumes coming through the filtration system.
Amazing. Well, I think you do get very strongly from the whole place, particularly a room like this, that everything is a kind of nicotine colour.
Yeah.
The light is so low, and then the ceilings are so low, and it's an amazingly evocative place to be, isn't it? I think more so than many of the wartime museums, because obviously there's much more of our daily lives infiltrating them. But this is it.
Yeah,
isn't
it's a real site. It's a real place. Yeah. They are making these decisions, and so many people were working down here. It's their daily lives.
Yes. Extraordinary to get this close to history. I mean, I would urge anybody who can to come and visit this place. It's a museum, but it's an amazingly authentic experience. But I would be very, very, very happy if people who watched it and enjoyed the episode would then come here to find out more about it. Because I think it's a testament to an extraordinary group of people and an extraordinary time. And our fictionalised version, I would like to think, in the best possible way, it sort of opens a door into finding out about history and about the Second World War in particular.
God, I think those who worked in the real cabinet war rooms must have had a tough time. If it was like it was, you know, it's not particularly pleasant. And, you know, there's people constantly losing their loved ones.
German bombers sighted over the channel, sir.
And it must have been utterly exhausting and terrifying, but I imagine quite exciting at times as well. There's a great sense of victory when there is victory, and I think there's a lovely beat in the episode where that happens, where there is real jubilation at sort of getting one up on the Daleks, which are, you know, as bad as the Nazis.
Dare I pizza!
To recreate that claustrophobia, the Doctor Who team take a trip to an old army centre.
Episode 3 was a joy to recreate the war rooms. We were just lucky that in Swansea we found this old command centre in West Cross, and it's just an incredible space. It hadn't been touched since the war, and it was sitting there empty. And we were just able to move in and recreate exactly what we wanted to, repaint, redecorate, and create the fantastic space. And then just to top it all off with putting Churchill in there was amazing, you know.
We're in the Joint Resilience Bunker of Swansea Council, down in the Mumbles. It's what we're using it for. It's a purpose-built sort of command centre for during the war. This was built for just after the war, I think, and it's used as a training centre for various military exercises. There's an army bunker next door, there's a TA centre. We know of quite a few bunkers around Cardiff and Newport, and we've used them in the past, and in this script it didn't quite lend itself for this. We were thinking of building it, so we looked at various options and just did a bit more digging around, and I just finally came up with this. They were quite miffed how we found it, because they think it's a secret bunker, but it's not going to be anymore. It's going to be all over Doctor Who.
Background action! Action! At last! Are they ready?
I hope so, but in the meantime...
The tables, the phone, that's all very authentic and real. That's taken from the real place, you know, down to the minute detail. But the space, the location, the actual room itself, is more of a command centre.
Yeah, the mock-up of the war rooms were, I mean, they were sort of better than the actual war rooms, I think. They were brilliant. The art team did fantastically well. And it was quite dingy, actually, and quite sort of damp. And I thought, I really wouldn't want to be under here for 2-3 months at a time. I just thought, those scenes have great energy. Lots of people coming and going and stuff.
And it was just really interesting to think that that's how things really were. And I suppose it was quite dingy in a way, but it had this real feel to it that kind of made it feel really real.
Hello? Sorry, who? No, seriously, who? Winston Churchill, before you.
The doctor is called in by Churchill, but he's late. And they're old friends. It's one of the interesting ideas about Steve had is that instead of being the time that he meets a historical figure, he actually has an ongoing relationship.
Oh, hello, dear. What's up?
Tricky situation, Doctor. Potentially very dangerous. You think I'm going to need you? 10 are all we've got!
What's he expect us to do now?
KBO, of course.
What?
Keep buggering on.
Winston Churchill is kind of this great heroic role in the episode, as he should be. It's Churchill.
My old friend.
Every time.
He has a lot of kind of similar traits to the Doctor, which is why they get on. He's ferociously intelligent, quite dogmatic, very brave.
He and Doctor Who have got a great relationship because they go way back. They've obviously worked with each other lots of times before. Think of what I could achieve with your remarkable machine, Doctor.
They're old sparring partners, you know. They get on very well, but they're not afraid to say a cross word to each other.
They're Daleks. They're called Daleks.
They are Bracewell's Ironsides, Doctor. Look, blueprints, statistics, field tests, photographs. He invented them.
Oh, no, no, no.
Yes.
And I think the Doctor actually really loves Churchill and has a lot of time and affection for him and will always go back and visit him.
Well, it's got Winston, Spencer, Churchill.
Have a cigar. Action this day, Breen. Action this day.
Yes, sir.
I kind of wanted to get the Churchill from the posters. And examine to what extent that was true.
We will mete out to the Germans the measure, and more than the measure, they have meted out to us.
Churchill is a mass of contradictions, which is partly the reason we're still so fascinated by him. The Second World War, which people call the last good war, needed a man of his absolute pragmatism. The extraordinary thing was he became absolutely the man and the hour, that the perfect war leader for the Second World War. He's an extraordinary figure, brave, tenacious, a brilliant speaker.
We will have no truce or parley with you or the grisly gang who work your wicked will. You do your worst, and we will do our best.
He was simultaneously
illiberal and curiously liberal in some ways. He was vehemently opposed to the Nazis from very early on and never wavered from that.
Along that wicked man will torture and afflict the nation. How often or in what directions he will set his murder machine in motion, we cannot tell.
I mean, he had extraordinary people around him. His generals were extraordinary, I think, a lot of them. And it's just that extraordinary thing that can happen every now and then, that the right person comes along. He's not a universally loved figure at all, very controversial. So to some extent, you have to be very careful where you're treading. I think in the end, it came down to sort of printing the Churchill of legend, because Doctor Who is not the place really to examine those sort of things, except wherever possible, in the gaps, in the shadows, you can suggest his pragmatism. So in this episode, when the Doctor, despite the fact the Doctor is telling him that the Daleks are the worst thing in the entire universe, he thinks, I can end the war quicker, I can save lives. So that sort of thing was interesting to play with. But I did, you know, it just isn't the place to try and have those conversations, because it's an adventure series.
Churchill's pragmatism leads the Doctor Who team onto a roof in Cardiff to meet Winston's rather unexpected allies.
And background action! Action!
Ready, Bracewell!
Aye, aye, sir!
On my order! Fire!
Show me what that was!
Advance! Our new secret weapon!
When the Doctor first sees the Daleks on the rooftop, it's just, you know, that frightening sort of surprise. And, you know, you meet your greatest enemy who is suddenly reformed, and you're the only one that knows, there's no way that this person could possibly be that kind or that nice or that sensible or that anything. So it's fear and anger and terror and annoyance.
This is one of my iron sights.
You're what?
You will help the Allied cause in any way that you can.
Yes!
Until the Germans have been utterly smashed.
Yes!
And what is your ultimate aim?
To win the war!
They are appearing to be something other than they are. When they're first encountered, they are khaki Daleks with little Union flags on them, and they appear to be a British secret weapon. And part of the fun of writing them like that is to give them things they could never normally have. They're servile, and they offer people cups of tea.
Would you care for some tea?
To actually be able to write, would you like a cup of tea, in a Dalek's voice box is rather thrilling.
And are they of assistance?
Shut it. I think Russell T. Davis, who said that there's something very World War II about them. It is actually possible, you know, because they don't goose step, but they do that. And I think essentially you can overplay it, but I think that's probably the root of them, definitely. The idea of the original story of them seeking to destroy anything unlike anything other is a very Nazi concept.
And the concept of total Dalek racial purity leads to a new paint job for the new kids on the block.
Ah, oh, I love the new Daleks.
It's all new Doctor Who. What's the other thing we haven't changed? Let's change the Daleks too. We wanted them bigger and more colourful, and we wanted more of them.
My heart skips a beat when I open a script and it says the Daleks, you know, because you just know that it's going to be fun.
Behold the restoration of the Daleks, the resurrection of the Master Race.
Oh, they're just magnificent. They're really cool. I think everyone's going to like them.
Question is, what do we do now? Either you turn up your clever machine or I'll blow you and your new paradigm into eternity.
And yourself!
Occupational hazard.
I think the blue one's my favourite. And they've all got sort of kind of different classes. There's a warrior, there's a scientist, there's a drone. And the white one is the supreme, and they've got he's got the deep, great, deep voice.
You are the doctor! You must be exterminated!
Don't mess with me, sweetheart.
I must admit, I still can't quite get my head around the fact that I was the director that got to shoot 8 Daleks in one room together. It's like the best job in the world, really, for a director on Doctor Who, to have the new Daleks.
Scan reveals nothing. God is self-destructivized, non-existent.
All right. It's a jammy dodger, but I was promised tea.
They're cool. They're like these massive, I mean, they're taller than me. The original ones are actually smaller than me, so they've made them huge, and they're all these primary bright colours.
These are the kind of Aryan Daleks. They are 100% old-fashioned, pure Dalek genome. That's what the story is about. They are the last of the Daleks are trying to find their purest form. So it gave us an opportunity to restore them. Having come back in the last 5 years, they sort of go away again, and really the idea was to sort of make sure that, you know, they're always with us. By having a drone who sort of feels like the foot soldier, a scientist, a strategist, a supreme, obviously, and an eternal, who knows, then it felt like you're sort of saying this is the new team, and from this you could, I suppose, have a story that is entirely staffed with red Daleks because they're all drones.
Cleanse the unclean, total obliteration, disintegrate.
Mark and I had great fun making up names for the Daleks, and we were particularly specific that those names must never reveal too much, and Mark came up with 4. And threw up his hand and said, I can't think of any more. And I suggested Eternal. And he said, well, what's an Eternal? I said, I don't know. I haven't a clue to this day what the Eternal is. But it sounds cool, and I bet it's really important. And someday, I bet you, that Eternal will be really important in a future Doctor Who.
With a whole host of brand spanking new Daleks to play with, the new operators are put through a Dalek driving school.
Looking good? What we're doing here today is we're trying out the new Daleks for the first time, and we've got some new guys to go inside them as well. So Barnaby and I are doing our best not only to familiarise ourselves with the new Daleks, but to help the new guys out as well in just some basic techniques of travelling, turning, moving, using the plunger and the gun and all those sort of things.
Whee! Beautiful plunger action.
We're discovering things, of course, you know, few little teething troubles, but it seems to be going really well, yeah. Okay, so let's start off with some quite straightforward stuff. Heads to the left. Just glide between these two white posts. That's good, that's good. Okay, very good indeed.
That's very well done.
Give it your best shot. Beautiful. Textbook stuff. Fantastic. You're doing really well, guys. I'm very impressed.
Well, gosh, they're much bigger. We haven't seen Daleks this big before. And bigger means heavier. But also, I think they move in a much more sort of menacing fashion because they're just so big and they're so heavy. They sort of trundle along like tanks, and we're having slight difficulty stopping them. So
distance is considerably, yeah.
I hope we don't have to come down a sort of big slope and hit them. And the good thing is that, you know, because there's so many different layers, like a wedding cake, to take it all apart, you all have to sort of look after each other. And I think that because once you've been inside a Dalek, you know how uncomfortable it is and how awkward it is. And I think the great thing about certainly all the new guys that we've had is that they've instantly fallen into a sort of routine of, you know, let's see if we get him out now, get the steps and pull him out and things like that. So it's much better.
Yes. And so it's great camaraderie, isn't it?
Oh, it is. It's very good.
It's like a family, you know, it's like a little family getting back together again.
Right from the start, I wanted them to be very colourful. The Dalek movies seem to cast a bit of a long shadow suddenly, which is, but I think that's great because for me, as a kid, those two films were the only versions of those two famous Dalek stories we ever had, apart from the books, you know. I'm terribly fond of them. And there's something so gorgeously impressive about those big, big, bloody Daleks with their colourful liveries that kind of look like minis, you know. You can feel like you can get in one and drive one around. So I just thought, you know, let's go for it, really. And happily, everybody else thought the same.
You can't go too far with that design. We did try like a few different things that were a bigger departure, and you just go, oh, it's not a Dalek now. There are certain cues you need. You need those strange baubles, you need that dome, you need the eye stalk. But it was time just to have a really noticeably different and more frightening Dalek.
We'd initially designed the original Daleks for the new series to be the same eye height as Billy, so that the eye stalk was the same eye height as Billy. On this, we had a much taller assistant, which means the eye stalk could go up, you know, which meant that we could make them much bigger. So that's exactly what we did. There's a lot of Art Deco in there. There's a lot of new sort of angle shapes to them. They're much stronger. Most of the things are still there. The sucker's there, the eye stalk's there, little round bombs on the sides are there. When you actually see them now next to the Daleks gone by, they're much more scary, I think.
Blimey. What do you do to the ones who mess up?
Steve had a fantastic idea, which is here, of giving them a living eye, just to remind people that within this sort of tank, there is this creature.
If you look at the original script, Terminator's original script, he does talk about the eye being live inside there. And it never really happened. There's one or two moments you see an iris contracting and so on. I just thought, instead of just a painted-on blob or a light, why not actually remind people there's a living thing in there? There's a nasty squidge of matter. And I sort of imagine there's a sort of optical nerve all the way up, and through its eye stalk, you've got a living eye sitting inside there. It's sort of icky and frightening, but rather great, I think.
The Daleks are scary, I think, because we're all kind of aware of the ruthlessness of them and the fact that they will never, ever show any mercy and they will just exterminate when they can. And I think that sort of knowledge of them really scares me.
They're very exciting things to be around, because I mean, look at them. There's one, look now. I'm sort of in love with them, that's the problem. I mean, they're my arch greatest enemy, of course, but it's like when I sort of saw the TARDIS for the first time and the blue of it, and you go, wow. And it's the same with the Daleks, it's something so striking. It's, you know, I mean, everyone in Britain sort of knows what that is, don't they?
It's like British icons shoved together. You know, Churchill is a British icon, that the Union Jack's a British icon. Everything about the war somehow is somehow our noblest hour surviving that blitz. Bizarrely, the Daleks feel as though they're part of it. In their design, they just look so right. When we slap those Union Jacks on them, it's scary how right that looks.
And I'm going to prove it.
And I'd been to that underground bunker shortly before we started working that episode, and I couldn't get out of my head that you had to see a Dalek would look so appropriate motoring around those desks and maps.
We stand at a crossroads, Doctor, quite alone, with our backs to the wall. Invasion is expected daily.
I was just really excited to see who was going to play him, because he's such an iconic figure in history. And then Ian McNeice came in and did this great version of him.
So I will grasp with both hands the anything that will give us an advantage over the Nazi menace.
Ian McNeice was great. Very funny. Me and Karen loved him.
I've never seen such a fine uppercut in my life, my whole 65 years.
That's Winston Churchill telling me that as well.
True. Just Rocky Marciano.
And I think Ian just plays him brilliantly and captures all that stuff, all that iron, all that grit, all that determination, all that class and humour and fun that's in there as well. And, you know, there's a lot of... It's very ironic and quite funny and naughty.
Now, I don't give a damn if you're a machine, Bracewell. Are you a man?
Rather than doing like a Mike Yarwin impersonation, I tried to get the essence of the man. I mean, he was such an incredible, iconic character that it's a tough call, so not everybody will get what I'm doing, but it's really the essence of the man rather than impersonation. His humour, his wit, his bluster, his courage, his compassion, all those things you've got to put into it, really, and try and give an overall feeling of Churchill. I mean, with someone like Churchill, there's so much news footage and stuff like that and all his speeches as well, and so he has a special way of speaking too. So, yeah, so, I mean, it's a challenge. It's a huge challenge to try and pull all that off.
Churchill had a journalist's eye for a great quotation and a way of speaking and a way of making words land for maximum effect, which I think he basically perfected once he was into Parliament.
We shall fight in France. We shall fight on the seas and oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air.
The voice is based basically on a lot of the speeches that you can still hear.
We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.
The cadences go up and down like that. It's that sort of feeling, really. You know, it's very sort of earnest, very ponderous, very, very, very Churchill.
So bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its Commonwealth last for 1,000 years, men will still say, this was their finest hour.
Now, when he gives that speech about the coming of the Battle of Britain, he times it like a piece of music, you know, that if the British Empire and its dominions last for 1,000 years,
men will still say, this was their finest hour.
And he hits that so much you actually sort of sit up and then actually fades away. He knows exactly where to hit it, like a conductor, you know. It must have been an incredible thing to listen to. They don't come along very often. I think you only have to look at how rarely a politician's speech actually makes people get stirred or emotional or proud or anything these days.
Being a good politician requires having good people around you. And Churchill recruits the brightest of the bright.
Bracewell is a robot, and the Daleks have invented him created him to back up their story. But he has a sort of Pinocchio-like existence because he remembers real things.
They made me. I can remember things. So many things. The last war. Squalor and the mud and the awful, awful misery of it all.
It came as much of a shock to him as it would to any of us. And of course, all that that means in terms of sort of psychological trauma, you know, when you think you're one thing and you're told you're something else, I think that stands to reason that he would be upset.
41, take 1A, camera only.
Background action. Action.
Doctor! Oh,
sorry, Professor, you're a bomb, an inconceivably massive Dalek bomb.
What the?
There's an oblivion continuum inside you, a captured wormhole that provides perpetual power.
The Doctor is trying to get Bracewell to engage with his humanity, to remember that he's not a robot, he's a human being. And if he thinks human thoughts, that this bomb won't explode because he'll be able to control it.
There's a blue wire or something you have to cut, isn't there? There's always a blue wire or a red one.
You're not helping.
It's incredible. He talked to us of his memories, the Great War.
Someone else has stolen thoughts and planted in a positronic brain. Tell me about it, Bracewell. Tell me about your life.
When the clock is at 11:58, as it were, Amy comes in with, have you ever fancied someone you shouldn't? And it's really a sort of, it's actually the one that's most likely to make you feel the most human.
They cannot explode that bomb. You are Professor Edwin Bracewell. You are a human being.
Hey, Paisley. Ever fancied someone you know you shouldn't?
What?
Hurts, doesn't it?
She saves the day again in a very brilliant way.
But kind of a good hurt.
And she just very tenderly allows Bracewell to remember.
Dorabella.
Dorabella? It's a lovely name. It's a beautiful name.
What was she like, Edwin?
Such a smile.
Sometimes the Doctor lacks a little bit of understanding of human emotions because at the end of the day, he is an alien and he's from another planet. And that's kind of where Amy sort of makes up for that. And that's why they make such a good team.
And her eyes. Her eyes were so blue. Almost violet.
like the last touch of sunset.
I'm very, very, very fond of as an ending, because it's not just about having a huge explosion. You actually, you know, we have all the grandeur of the Spitfire dogfight and the Daleks in space, but actually in the end, the thing that saves us is a piece of common humanity and slight embarrassment, which is probably the most human thing of all.
Doorbell.
Before I wrote this script, I'd read an awful lot of stuff, diaries and first-hand accounts from the Battle of Britain, which, I admired enormously anyone who'd been through that war, but by the time I'd finished, my admiration had gone through the roof. It's the most extraordinary period. Sort of, almost everybody was amazing in their small way, however they coped or didn't cope. I mean, it's the sort of thing we simply can't imagine today, the idea that you would see someone like this, and then the next day, maybe everybody else in this room is dead. I was reading some extraordinary things about the RAF, and in order to cope with the loss of their best friends, they would, when they got back from a mission, a lot of them would just go and get utterly hammered, understandably. But the next day, they had to be back in the air. So they used to get up the next morning, go and sit in their planes, and put their oxygen masks on just to sober themselves up. This is the way the war was won. And it was a hair's breadth between victory and defeat. Absolutely extraordinary time. I suppose it was a bit like, it's like if everybody had a newborn child. People would go to work and they hadn't slept at all because of the bombings. And cumulatively, everyone got rattier and more filthy and exhausted. And then they got very used to it. And then some people got slightly more scared. And other people got incredibly blasé. And they started to quite enjoy it. You know, people go through all kinds of odd things. I mean, it's the sort of thing that in our existence, it would traumatize you for the rest of their life, and probably did then. But it, as an accumulation of horrors and extraordinary experiences, you know, it's an amazing time.